Hello, I'm Grace Farrell, and this is the 86 Floors review of Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell. We're going to be asking, did it work as an adaptation of the book, and did it work as a TV series? Susanna Clark's novel has been hailed as a modern classic by many readers and reviewers, including no less a reviewer than Neil Gaiman. It chronicles the tale of two magicians and their tempestuous relationship as they revive the wild art of magic in early 19th century England. Although popular with critics, at over 600 pages long with a mountain of witty asides to boot, the novel's always been regarded as unfilmable. So when the BBC announced that it would be adapted into a TV series, the news was met with somewhat guarded enthusiasm. But does it work? In short, yes. With the novel's labyrinthine nature, multiple plot threads, and its truly mammoth cast, it was never going to be an easy adaptation. But the series does a really good job at conveying all of this. And despite the worries that were floating around about the budget, the special effects are quite frankly exceptional. What's good? Bertie Carvel is the standout in this ensemble piece as Jonathan Strange. His journey through magic, going from almost a Mr. Darcy-like character to a tortured widower, is mesmerising. He brings real weight and pathos to the journey of Strange, as well as remaining incredibly likeable throughout. Eddie Marsden is also quietly excellent as Mr. Norrell. The reticent desperation and loneliness of his character is brought out in full by his performance, although, as we'll discuss later, he's often relegated to show, don't tell by the script. Another strong feature is the period setting. The BBC always excel at costume drama, so we knew we were in safe hands in that respect, and to see their expertise added to the fantasy story is really something to behold. The ensemble cast is also good. The entire cast shines through, although particularly noteworthy is Mrs. Tom Hardy, Charlotte Riley, as Arabella Strange. He manages to create a compelling and resolute female antagonist without falling into any of the fantasy genre traps at home Game of Thrones. Arion Bacare also stands out as Stephen Black, as does Mark Warren as the gentleman with the thistledown hair. They all create roles that feel lived in. Bacare in particular brings real weight to some of the scenes that were even more harrowing than in the book. So what's great? We'd say that the all-round visualisation and realisation of the story is probably the biggest surprise of the production. The makers of the show have created a world of magic that's terrifying, enchanting, and thoroughly wild. From the scenes of Lost Hope, to the Napoleonic Wars, to the seahorses summoned by Mr. Strange, the world is eerily real and the accompanying effects are, again, amazing. So, what's not good? Well, given how much we liked the series, this is definitely the hardest section of the review. However, the most glaring fault in the show is the predominant focus on Jonathan Strange. It's a natural decision, as he's easily the most likeable character of the pair, but we would have liked more screen time for Gilbert Norrell to put his point of view across, because, in our opinion, Eddie Marsden is one of the most watchable, quiet actors in the world. While we're on the subject, the way Norrell was portrayed marked an interesting departure from the novels because, until Christopher Drawlight is revealed as the most villainous character, it was easy to assume Norrell was the villain, even though his role in the novel was always much more ambiguous. But to get to the crux of the matter, what we're really missing is the chance to spend more time with Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell together. Given the relationship in the books, it would have been beneficial to have seen them spend more time together on the actual revival of English magic, because this bit in itself is enough to fill a whole series, really. However, this is just the flip side of another problem in the series, and that it's just not long enough. The amount of tales that Susanna Clark wove into the world of Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell is staggering, and while we felt the programme makers generally made the right choices, it would have been good to see those footnotes brought to life, either as asides within the show, or even maybe as web content. And finally, there's John Usglass. Now, this was always going to be a difficult role, as his presence in the book defines so many of the character's actions without ever actually being present. Still, we thought the actor chosen to play the Raven King, while he certainly was spooky, didn't really convey the full, immense, supernatural menace of the King in the North. Please note, these really are just nitpicking points given the overall triumph of the series. The BBC's shown it can do fantasy as a mainstream Sunday evening show in a way that gives even Game of Thrones a run for its money. The TV industry keeps on producing great original fantasy in the way that cinema really just isn't doing at the moment, and we hope this continues. Did you enjoy Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell? What would you have left in that the producers left out? Are you a supporter of the Strange or Norrellite camp of English magic? And finally, will Phil Kay ever play another role that's not a deranged lunatic again? Let us know in the comments below, and if you've enjoyed this, please like the video. If you've loved it, you can subscribe, and if it's the greatest thing you've ever seen, then please share. I'm Grace Varell, and this is The 86th Floor. Thanks for watching.